I'm more disappointed about losing that than I was when I lost Mary twice at Razorry.
It's very nice to meet you, Mr. Chillcott. Thank you for letting us ask you some questions. Why are you famous?
Why am I famous? There is a very leading question. I think I'm well known, I'll call it, in carp fishing and in other parts of my life I've been involved in, because I enjoy life. And it's never been about the size of the carp you catch, it's about the size of the smile that it puts on your face. And I think as long as I keep liking what I'm doing and smiling about it, then I can hopefully be popular and help people within fishing.
Do you like eating chili?
Do I like eating chili? Yes, I do. I love spicy food. So a nice chili, a strong Indian. Yeah, I do like it. But chili is pretty unusual for me to say. Pretty damn cool.
What is the biggest fish that you have caught?
Right. I have caught some big fish abroad in very commercial venues, but I treat that as a bit of a holiday, which is no reflecting whatever everybody gets individually what they want from fishing. The biggest fish I've caught in this country is 53 pounds and 12 ounces, and it was an inordinately special fish. But some of the most special fish I've ever caught are an awful lot smaller than that.
How old were you when you started fishing?
Wow, yes. Well, fishing has weaved its way through my life for now. That'll be 54 years. I was 4 years old. My parents took me to Beer in Devon. We used to have a caravan down there. And the first fish I ever caught at 4 years old on a tiny little solid glass fishing rod we bought in a shop in the town with a tiny little centre pin reel was a ballon ras from the rocks on a bit of limpet. And from that day till this, it's made me smile just the same.
Which fish was your favourite?
My favourite fish? It's a toughie because there's loads of favourite fish, if that makes any sense. I would suggest one that sticks in my mind, and it goes back to what I said earlier, one of the smaller fish. When I went to Horton Church Lake back in 1996, it was the hardest lake, one of the hardest lakes in the country to get a fish from. It was the third night I did there, and I baited a little spot in the edge, fished the night, and in the morning I put a bait in there and I caught a carp, a mirror carp, that weighed 20 pounds and 12 ounces. And a lot of people, because we were fishing for 40 pounders, a lot of people didn't take any notice of it. I was told it was a fish called Polly. I had my photograph taken, I was happy as hell, put it back, and it wasn't until 10 years later I found out I was the first person that ever caught that fish. Before it was moved into Horton, it lived for about 30 years in Longfield, a lake a little bit down the road. And it lived there all that time, and it was fished for by the best anglers in the world at the time. And nobody ever caught it. And I was the first person that ever caught that fish. It's called the missing mirror. And I think that is what makes carp fishing at times such a special thing.
Polly's a nice name.
Polly's a good name.
Do you like fish and chips?
I do like fish and chips, and the irony of being here today for the Brain Tumour charity is the fact of how much my tastes have changed in food. I don't eat a lot of vegetables anymore. I eat raw spinach and tomatoes and maybe a little bit of ham. I only eat meat. I don't eat bread anymore or anything like that. But you've made me smile, actually. On the way home, I'm half tempted to stop at the nearest fish and chip shop and buy it. So, answer to your question, yes, I love it. Whether I'm going to eat it or not, I don't know.
What job did you do before you did fishing?
In sort of reference to the crazy life I've led, I used to jump out of aeroplanes. When I was your age, all I ever dreamed about was going fishing and being a paratrooper. And that, in the end of the day, I ended up, and there aren't many people that do that in the British Army, with 22 years of, I was paid every month extra money as parachute pay, and that helped in a lot of reasons. But that's all I ever wanted to be, a fisherman and a paratrooper, and I achieved it all, thankfully.
How did you first find out that you had something wrong with your brain?
Right, this is something you three need to take on board. men are the most stupid people in the world at times, and we ignore the things that are wrong with us. 4 years ago, I was, and this is a bit of a long answer, I apologise, but 4 years ago I was fishing a lake up in the Cotswolds called Farrier's Lake, belongs to the Carp Society.
Four years ago.
And I was getting some dizzy spells, and I'd get these moments, it was almost like an out-of-body experience, and I'd just sort of float above my bivvy, and it was weird. They'd last about 20 minutes, it would go away. There were other things happening in my life, excesses. I was drinking coffee with three extra shots of coffee in it and 10 sugars. And I put it down to that in the end, that I was drinking too much coffee. I gave it up, I was still getting those things. Eventually I got dizziness and sickness for a while, that went away, then it was just dizziness, then it was sickness. And eventually, the end of last June in 2017, my left eye started going bad, and I went to Frimley Park Hospital. I saw an eye specialist a couple of weeks later. He insisted that I have an MRI scan, which is a real in-depth photograph of what's going on in your brain, and he rang me himself, not his secretary or anybody else, and said, you'll come and see me at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. There'll be no queue, there'll be no nothing, you'll walk straight into my office. And he told me I had a brain tumor. I thought it was a tiny little thing. They'd drill a hole in my head, take it out, and I'd be fishing the following week. And I went to see Mr. Stapleton at St. George's Hospital up in London, in Tooting in London. And he showed me the picture. He wanted to operate the day before, but there was preparation for the operation. It was that, it had got that bad. And on the 10th of August last year, 2017, they operated in a massively long 14-hour operation, and because of the situation and the way that I was on the operating table, they were able to remove all of it. I didn't end up having radiotherapy or anything to get rid of any little bits and pieces. And yeah, I've jumped out of aeroplanes, I've done some of those crazy stuff on the planet, and I can assure you that was the most frightening period of my life. But I'm here. You don't get rid of me that easy, okay? Did they take my brain out? There wasn't a lot of it to take out, I don't think.
Yeah, it was just a lump.
It was a big lump, and what they do, if you look at the scar, I think I put one on my Facebook, they cut the front, basically the front of your head comes off, and then they can access your brain without taking it back. I'm glad they didn't take it out. They wouldn't have had to have much lifting gear to get something that small out, but no, I owe them my life, and yeah, wonderful people.
How much brain did they put back in?
Ah, now that is a very leading question. Probably not a lot, actually, but you know, one of the things I found out about all of this, I mean, my brain is still trying to re-establish itself in the hole that the thing left, so that takes a little while. It upsets me from time to time. I feel a bit poorly and whatever, but I'm getting over it. The brain is the most amazing thing you could ever think of. I've met people through all of this that have lost half of their brain, but they still operate completely normally as a human being. So, you know, there's hope for everyone, thankfully, and I just wish that hope came true for everyone.
Why do we need to raise money for brain tumour charity?
Why do we need to do it? Because the more that people with big brains who know what they're doing will be able to help people who got in with the problems that I've got. Mine at the end of the day was quite a, although it was a massive thing, it was a huge long operation, it was a relatively straightforward thing. We've had little Robert up here today, a local lad who's had five tumours in his brain, and they're working on him at the moment. And it is people like that that will benefit from money that is pumped into a system that researches it. And to me, military charities have been crucial to me all of my life, or certainly since I've left the army. And because brain cancers and tumours are so little understood, I intend to turn all my attention and all my efforts to funding them.
Why is fishing so important to you?
Why is it so important to me? Jeez, we could be here for some considerable time to tell you. There's certain aspects of my life that I don't sort of talk about this pressures you come under in certain ways. I'll talk about post army now. With the illness with my wife has suffered with various cancers for 25 years. She's had two strokes and she's registered blind. You wouldn't believe it if you ever saw her, but fishing allowed me, and it might sound awfully selfish, to disappear from that just for a little while, even if it was just for a few hours, and put those things to the back of my mind for a little while. And that's what fishing does to me. It sounds selfish, but when I hook a carp, or any fish to be honest with you, I can think of nothing else. And that, I think, has saved my sanity for, as I say, the last 54 years.
Thank you for letting us ask you these questions today.
Well, thank you for asking me.
Now can you teach us how to fish?
The pleasure would be all mine.